Pilih jarum yang pasti aja. Bagus kualitasnya, bagus tampilannya, bagus hasil akhirnya. Vinilex, garansi hasil cek bagus.
Halo, gue Mansan. Gue adalah full-time content creator dan streamer Valorant di YouTube. Nah, gue itu main Valorant tuh dari awal banget sih. Dari pertama.
Online aja Bu. Iya, gabung Bu. Jujur dengan online aja. Itu bagi Zoom jadi bisa langsung. Iya, biar. Ini saya iya. Iya. Minjemnya.
Cek.
Ini hostnya siapa? Ini anak-anak. Bentar. Yang belum
recording in progress. Thank you.
Halo? Ya, gimana? Oh ya udah, beli.
Bismillah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa bihi nasta'in wa ala umurid dunya waddin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala asrofil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain amma ba'du. Bismillah, segala puji bagi Allah Subhanahu wa taala wabarakatuh. Yang mana alhamdulillahirabbil alamin kita nasta'in wa ala dapat berkumpul di tempat yang insyaallah barokah insalin wa ala alihi shalawat teriring salam. Marilah kita curahkan segala bagi dalam Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yang terhormat Dekan Fakultas Ekonomi dan Bisnis UIN Syarif Hidayatullah Jakarta, Prof. Dr. Amilin SE AK MSI. Yang terhormat Wakil Dekan 2 Bidang Administrasi Umum, Bapak Dr. Suhendra MM. Yang terhormat Ketua Prodi Perbankan Syariah, Ibu Cut Erika Ananda Fatimah SE MBA. Yang terhormat Sekretaris Prodi Perbankan Syariah, Ibu Dr. Yuke Rahmawati MA. Yang terhormat narasumber pada acara hari ini, Ibu Dr. Irina Safitrizen. Yang terhormat moderator pada hari ini, Ibu Ai Mariani SE MSI, serta para hadirin Bapak Ibu dosen yang hadir pada acara hari ini, baik menghadiri secara offline maupun online, yang kami banggakan. Demi lancarnya acara pada hari ini, marilah bersama-sama kita awali dengan membaca lafal basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Baiklah, meningkat acara yang selanjutnya yaitu sambutan-sambutan. Sambutan yang pertama yaitu sambutan dari Wakil Dekan 2 Bidang Administrasi Umum yang akan disampaikan oleh Bapak Dr. Suhendra MM. Kepadanya waktu dan tempat dipersilakan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa bihi nasta'in wa ala umuri dunya waddin. Salatu wassalamu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. Marilah kita panjatkan puji dan syukur kita kehadirat Allah Subhanahu wa taala, di mana atas nikmat dan karunia-Nya kita masih diberi kesempatan untuk dapat bermuajahah pada hari ini, baik secara daring maupun luring. Salawat dan salam senantiasa kita sanjungkan kepada junjungan kita Nabi besar Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sebagai contoh dan suri tauladan bagi kita semua. Pertama kami ucapkan ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bi hudurik fi hadzal jami'ah. Selamat datang kepada Bapak Ibu Dr. Irina Safitrizen dari IIUM ya. IIUM. Yang kami hormati Ibu Kaprodi Program Studi Perbankan Syariah beserta Ibu Sekprodi, Bapak Ibu dosen di lingkungan Fakultas Ekonomi dan Bisnis UIN Syarif Hidayatullah Jakarta, dan mungkin ada juga Bapak dosen-dosen yang berasal dari luar UIN Jakarta. Kemudian mungkin ada mahasiswa-mahasiswa juga yang hadir pada kesempatan hari ini. Alhamdulillah program studi manajemen, program studi perbankan syariah ya, karena baru kemarin manajemen. Perbankan syariah hari ini akan mengadakan workshop. Nah, workshop yang pembicaranya dari internasional juga ya. Artinya kita sudah mulai internasionalisasi Bu Reskino ya. Ini akibat Bu Rahma dan Bu Reskino balik. Ini jadi menularkan. Nah, kemarin dari Monash University, sekarang dari IIUM. Mudah-mudahan hari ini kita kedatangan tamu sekaligus narasumber kita, Ibu Dr. Irina Safitri, akan berbagi informasi, berbagi pengetahuan tentang asynchronous training for research design. Artinya memang di era teknologi informasi ini semuanya sudah didesain sedemikian rupa ya, tidak ada batasan ruang dan waktu lagi. Jadi kita bisa belajar dari mana saja, nah, di asinkronus, ya, bisa dari rumah, bisa dari Indonesia, bisa dari Amerika dan sebagainya. Nah mungkin banyak juga ya dosen, kita sebagai dosen belum terbiasa memanfaatkan artinya knowledge sharing, Bu ya. Bagaimana knowledge dalam manajemen pengetahuan itu ada namanya knowledge sharing, berbagi ilmu pengetahuan, berbagi informasi. Nah, mungkin saat ini atau hari ini kita akan belajar mencoba bagaimana mengaplikasikan ya dan menerapkanlah katakan berbagi pengetahuan itu dalam kehidupan kita sehari-hari khususnya dalam pengembangan ilmu pengetahuan. Baik, Bapak Ibu sekalian, mungkin itu ya tema daripada workshop kita kali ini. Mudah-mudahan dapat kita ikuti dengan baik dan dapat kita ambil hikmah dan pelajaran dari setiap kejadian yang terjadi pada hari ini. Ya. Kami ucapkan sekali lagi terima kasih kepada Ibu Dr. Irina Savitri yang sudah berkesempatan dan mau berbagi ilmu pengetahuan dengan kita. Mudah-mudahan kita semua dapat mengikutinya dan baik. Baiklah, marilah kita buka workshop program studi perbankan syariah hari ini dengan sama-sama membaca basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Selamat berdiskusi. Mohon maaf atas segala khilafan. Billahi taufik wal hidayah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih kepada Bapak Dr. Suhendra MM atas sambutannya. Sambutan selanjutnya yaitu sambutan dari Ibu Cut Erika Ananda Fatima SEMBA selaku Ketua Program Studi Perbankan Syariah. Kepada beliau dipersilahkan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya singkat saja mungkin ya karena sudah waktunya sangat mepet. Terima kasih untuk pertama-tama saya ucapkan terima kasih untuk narasumber kita hari ini, Ibu Dr. Irina Zain. Dan terima kasih juga untuk teman-teman dosen yang ada di sini, yang secara offline maupun secara online. Terima kasih juga untuk teman-teman dari APS-KPS yang juga hadir secara online. Dan mahasiswa, dan tidak lupa juga kepada Bu Yuke, terima kasih, Sekprodi yang sudah standby. Semoga acara workshop ini memberi manfaat untuk kita semua, menambah ilmu untuk kita semua, dan tentunya menambah jejaring ataupun networking kita ke IIUM. Itu saja mungkin sambutan dari saya ya, karena biar waktu belajarnya lebih lama. Oke, terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih kepada Ibu Cut atas sambutannya. Baiklah, tidak lama kembali kita akan berlanjut ke acara selanjutnya, yaitu pemaparan materi yang akan dimoderatori oleh Ibu Ai Mariani SEMSI. Sedikit biografi tentang beliau. Ibu Ai adalah dosen tetap Prodi Perbankan Syariah FEB UIN Syarif Hidayatullah Jakarta. Riwayat pendidikan S1 akuntansi di FEB UIN Syarif Hidayatullah Jakarta, S2 akuntansi di Universitas Trisakti Jakarta, dan saat ini beliau sedang menjalani studi doktoral manajemen dan keuangan lembaga syariah di Sekolah Pasca Sarjana UIN Syarif Hidayatullah Jakarta. Kepada beliau waktu dan tempat dipersilahkan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ya, terima kasih atas waktunya. Sebelum lanjut ke pemateri, saya akan membacakan biodata mengenai narasumber kita hari ini. Tentunya mohon maaf tidak bisa membacakan semuanya. Banyak sekali soalnya. Ya. Ya, yang pertama nama beliau adalah Dr. Irina Savitri Zain. Betul ya, Bu? Ya. Terus saat ini beliau adalah asisten profesor di Departemen Perencanaan Wilayah dan Kota, Kuliah Arsitektur dan Desain Lingkungan pada Universitas Islam Internasional Malaysia. Terus pendidikan beliau PhD-nya pengelola lingkungan, pakai bahasa Indonesia, bukan? PhD-nya pengelola lingkungan dan pengelola lingkungan dan manajemen pengelola lingkungan. Keahlian beliau yaitu pengelolaan lingkungan, perencanaan sumber daya, dan pengelolaan dan kebijakan. Minat penelitian beliau pada urban governance, urban environment, environment behavior, dan behavioral economy. Mungkin sekedar itu saja profil mengenai narasumber kita hari ini. Mari kita lanjutkan dengan pemaparan materi dari beliau.
Terima kasih Ibu Mariani dan terima kasih juga kepada Green dan khususnya untuk Fakultas Fakultas Ekonomi dan juga Bisnis yang telah menjemput saya untuk sesi sharing knowledge ya untuk topik research design atau di bahasa Malaysia adalah reka bentuk kajian atau research ya. Terus aja saya akan share presentasi ini mungkin akan mengambil masa 40 sampai 50 menit dan setelah itu dilanjutkan kalau ada soal jawab ya, dari 10 menit. Dan kemudian diteruskan dengan sesi aktivitas learning menggunakan Padlet yang nanti saya akan sharing dalam mungkin saya boleh kasih ke Bu Irika boleh ya dan nanti mudah-mudahan yang online dan juga yang tidak di kampus UI juga bisa mengikuti dan melakukan aktiviti tersebut ya. Saya akan bermula dengan presentasi ini juga mungkin akan bercampur-campur dalam bahasa Inggris atau bahasa Malaysia yang mungkin alternately ya. Suara saya sudah jelas. Sudah jelas ya? Terima kasih, Pak. Ya, secara overall memang design your research is actually mainly for any research conducted by the student or the researcher atau lecturer, then and either qualitative or quantitative, and I'm advising you to use your own current research as a training material after this. First of all, the presentation consists of seven items. Yeah, where at first I will share with you on the research design definition, basic concept, element type, and characteristics. And then how is the difference between research methodology and research design? Yeah, yeah, ini kadang-kadang memang orang selalu saru ya. But then I will explain the difference between this research design and research methodology. The third one is dedicated for specifically for identification of independent variables and dependent variables to help us to designing our research. And the fourth item is on the how to determine our sampling dan juga method of data collections. Item number 5, the construction of measurement scaling, especially for quantitative data collection. And at the end, I will share with you a bit on how is the type of the qualitative data collections. Yeah? So basically, the research design is a framework yeah, for research method and the technique yang dipilih oleh peneliti untuk melakukan kajian ya. Jadi ia dilakukan di peringkat awal sebelum kajian itu dilakukan. Kemudian mungkin sudah ada topik, you have your own topic, then you are still not clear whether you want to pursue your research rather than qualitative. But if you are, let's say for example, you have a scientific case study on selected village or urban or kampung or any type of case study, then one can be part of either quantitative and qualitative. But then you have to be first what is the topic. Yeah? The design also is allows researcher to sharpen the research method. So after you design your research, and then you can design your research methodology. Yeah? And the creating of your research topic explain the type of research, some idea whether you want to use experimental. For example, if you want to select one topic, then you want to test whether there is a difference between group A, group B, woman and man in terms of behavioral, consumer behavior, and etc. That is part of experimental. On the survey research also is also part of this experimental, but you can do it by using questionnaire design that we'll explain later on. Correlation, semi-experimental, and also another type of research is subtype, like experimental design of descriptive case study. Yeah. Dan dalam research design juga kita menjawab soalan, ya, questions. Apa sih kajian yang akan dilakukan? Kenapa? Kenapa perlunya lakukan kajian tersebut? Di mana? Ya. Kalau simpelnya tuh five, pernah dengar nggak? Four wife, one husband, or one H, four W. Why, what, whom, who. So that is very easy to remember, ya. So this is actually based on these questions, ya. Dan di mana akan diperlukan data tersebut? Apakah data tersebut secondary data atau primary data? Itu adalah bagian daripada research design. Dan kenapa perlu research design? Ya, supaya sebelum awal-awal lagi kita buat research, kita perlukan research design supaya nanti kita nggak kadang-kadang kita hanyut, ya, terlalu asik buat literature review aja gitu kan, atau terlalu asik buat lihat case study kan, nanti lupa gitu kan, oh kita harus ada lagi untuk menentukan siapa respondennya, siapa tempatnya di mana, dan lain sebagainya. Jadi dengan adanya by having this research design, it helps you to be firm with your research, and then at the same time also to make sure that you are already on time, yeah, in time, and then you will answer the research question and research objective that you are already determined, yeah. Dan kita juga akan memastikan bahwa maklumat yang dicapai itu adalah dengan menggunakan research mana yang lebih efisien, yeah. Dan apakah data tersebut, result tersebut reliable dan valid, itu juga adalah bagian daripada research design yang akan ditentukan dalam pembentukan research design. Dan bagaimana sih sebenarnya research design yang baik tersebut, ya? Sebaik mungkin we generate maximum information, ya? Whether we want to collect the information at first, to screen through the newspaper for selected topic, for example, or literature review, so you have a various chosen of the information in order to determine whether your topic research is in line or in the current in line with the current topic, whether it's in our society or is part of the academic scholarly discussion. Yeah, for example, like I will choose my research topic on no plastic bag campaign. Yeah. For the past 10 years, I'm focusing my research on the No Plastic Bag campaign. That time, I already talking about on how is the what type of policy implementation for this kind of research. But now, through got time, since 2011, the second part of the research is focused on the consumer CSR. How is the CSR the company can help to strengthen this plastic bag campaign? And then this topic is evolved. Eh? Throughout the time, based on also the dynamic and then the competition of among the researcher that focus on this topic, yeah. So that is why your first topic screening is not only by using the newspaper topic or Google or by using the same keyword, but also at the scholarly discussion in article journal. That is why this is also of course to maximize our reliability results, ya. At the end, bila you dah sampai, dah selesai, lah, this topic is already researched by other researcher. I'm my research is output is too old to publish, or they already established a scholarly discussion for this topic. So that is very important for you. It's not only to establish your topic in the in scholarly discussions, yeah, what is the current topic, and then helps organizing one's ideas, give chance to foresee flaws and inadequacy. Yeah? So it's important for you also to develop your research mapping, yeah, research map, so that you know what is the gap, what are the elements involved in these topics. Then juga incorporate learning from others' critical comment, research, examine data critically, data validity and variability, and research specify the limits. Yeah? So that is the criteria for good research designs. And in overall, the type research design is consists of two types, whether quantitative and qualitative. I know you are already very familiar with this both type of the qualitative and quantitative. For quantitative, it's normally a theory driven, and it is impossible to know advance which variable are controlled or measured. So it's by testing this independent variable and variables by using this quantitative, you should able to determine that later on after the result, oh ternyata perilaku pengguna itu dipengaruhi oleh harga atau brand atau dan lain sebagainya. Dan juga untuk kualitatif, ya, perhaps this is more freedoms, and then perhaps the data collection also very open up for more informations, yeah. And then sometimes the qualitative is the started for you to develop the quantitative, yeah. So that is also sometimes the people, most of the, if you are aim for Q1, so I would advise you to start qualitative to quantitative first, so that is help you to rigorous more result at the end. Yeah, qualitative helps you to identify what are the items that are important that later on you want to test by using the quantitative. Yeah, and the research design element, if I can moving on to our next advance on the topic itself. Yeah, I would like you to prepare for our later on for our activity learning by using Padlet. What is your current purpose statement, objective of your study research, and then what is the technique, yeah, the collecting, what are the topic, the data collection, method of applying the to analyze the data, the objection to research, setting for the research study, timeline and measurement of the analysis. So this is basically the research design element for the element for the research designs. Then I hope we can start if you are already having this kind of research topic, or for your final year or for your master's thesis, you can use it for this at the end of our activity today for the activity learnings. Yeah, and this is the characteristic of the research design. We are also having these four type of the research design. You can Google also. This one is, I take it for some blog on the question pro. Yeah. So this basic of the characteristic is include the neutrality, reliability, neutrality maksudnya is free from bias and neutral. Yeah. So by having you as a researcher, you should able to position in yourself that you are not part of this research. For example, like kalau if you are part of this certain village, you are a community for this village, perhaps you have a bias. Yeah. So make sure that you choose this is not your hometown, for example. So that is another factor bias. The reliability, whether the researcher expects similar result every time to reach the desired result, is your design is reliable. This is very important to plan for this at the beginning, at the research design stage. Yeah. And the next one about the validity. You also need to make sure that the result at the end can answer your research objective or questions. Yeah. So at the end, especially for the conclusion of the report or the manuscript that you have prepared for this research. it should tailored back, matching back to your research question. So this is one of the way to check back whether your research is valid or not. Yeah. And in terms of generalization, for example, if you use the certain sample population for certain population with the same characteristic, so perhaps you can use the result at the end to the other society as well, yeah, or to test for certain hypotheses. Yeah. And moving on to the detail of the research design, this is also to help you to identify what are the category of research design and then what kind of activity that involve. Yeah, first category of the research design is involving the descriptive. Yeah, where the in this case you are describing certain situations. Yeah, and this research basically is a theory based design method that created by gathering, analyzing, and presenting collected data. Yeah. For example, like my previous study on the Bali Conservation, Bali UNESCO World Heritage Site. Yeah. So I use the World Heritage Site framework, and then I gather the information related to this framework, and then test it, and then at the end, analyzing it, and present the data collected to test whether the framework is reliable or not, or is aligned with this framework or not, the current practice. For the experimental research, we want, there are several efforts also, whether we want to test the relationship between cause and effect of the certain situation. In this scenario, we will identify what are the independent variable and dependent variables. We will further discuss later on. At the end, yeah, for the category of research design, through this this chart, yeah, perhaps it's easy for you to identify that in which category your research currently. If you are focused on the experimental or non-experimental, you will fall under quantitative. But if you are more on the phenomenology, you are trying to explain or to understand what is actually going on in current situation in our society, for example. Maybe I will use the phenomena or desa wisata, for example. Sekarang ini kenapa ya banyak banget ini desa wisata lagi booming gitu ya. This is tourism, for example. Oh yeah, because this is also a part of the post-pandemic. They are also trying to revive their life, yeah. Then desa wisata can be one of the post-COVID in terms of economic development for the rural, yeah, for the rural area. So, in order for you to identify that things, you will also perhaps you have to study and then to go there to set up the focus group discussion or in-depth interview. So this is part of the qualitative. Or if you want to start the case study, you can also select one village, for example, for to be one of your research, yeah, or any ada mungkin contoh lain daripada kawan-kawan untuk atau ibu-ibu bapak-bapak yang boleh sharing untuk case study atau grounded theory, atau nanti aja lepas setelah saya habis slide ya supaya lebih interaktif maksudnya setelah. Oh oke. Okay. Oh, okay. Pak kuliah. Okay. Kita alumni ya. Ya, dan yang paling penting kadang-kadang ya untuk yang mix method ini yang mungkin lebih banyak disukai ya, favoritism ya. Ada question so far? Is there any question so far? Belum ada ya. Okay, so mungkin saya akan teruskan dulu sampai memberikan contoh ya. Yang kategori yang ketiga adalah correlational research. Of course, this is also to helps to identify the relationship between two closely connected variables. Maybe you would like to know whether is there any correlation within certain one variable to another variable. This is also very important for many disciplines, yeah, most of the many disciplines also using this correlational research. And the correlation coefficient determinants determines the correlation between two variables. Of course, you are very familiar also with this coefficients, yeah. By the fourth type of category of the research design is by using diagnostic research to evaluate the underlying cause of the specific topic or phenomenon. Yeah. For example, like in my past research on the we would like to know on the recycling, so for example, recycling activity, but we want to know what type of recycler yang sudah melakukan recycle itu siapa saja, yang tidak melakukan recycle itu siapa saja, dan itu adalah satu fenomena ya. Mungkin untuk lebih lanjutnya, mungkin government akan membentuk satu kebijakan di mana untuk kawasan yang ternyata banyak yang melakukan recycling atau recycler, mereka adalah dari golongan yang berpendidikan atau berpendapatan tinggi dan lain sebagainya. Dan ini mungkin memberikan strategi untuk kebijakan memberikan infrastruktur fasiliti untuk kita semua yang berbeza berbanding dengan kawasan di mana recycling tersebut terdiri daripada kawasan di kawasan pedesaan dengan lebih kepada communal type dan berbanding daripada a single recycling bin from house to house. Yeah, this is example of how we use the diagnostic design. Untuk kategori yang kelima, explanatory research, is use a research ideas and thoughts on a subject to further explore their theory. So they explain and explore aspect of a subject and details the research question, what, how, and why. So this one I will also use my current research with the Sumitomo on the what is the model of Okayama model of Education for Sustainable Development, which is they are also inaugurated by the UNESCO as a sustainable society. So I would like to know whether what kind of society that are already labeled or labeled as a sustainable society by UNESCO. So this is also another explanatory research. Yeah? So from this type of various type of categories, so I would like to share with you also several type of category of the research that categorized as descriptive research design here, where by having this in-depth review and also FGD and also the survey, we are able to explain the descriptively yeah, what are the current connection between one of the complexity in terms of the scenario. In this case in Malaysia is about No Plastic Bag campaign, who are the stakeholders involved in this activity. We can also identify as a phenomenon because currently perhaps the initiative is there, but it's not clear how is the connection between those who are given the initiative and then the charges, and then how is the CSR involved in this activity. And then how is the consumer affected by this activity? And then who are, so this framework is actually resulted from this descriptive, then also the phenomenal type of the research. Yeah, it can be using the descriptive by using the percentage, statistical, quantitative research design. And this is example of the descriptive research also that it doesn't mean that we use this descriptive percentage, yeah, a very simple, doesn't mean that we cannot go into the Q1 type of article journal. Yeah. But then again, by having research design mixed method give us more chance for us to publish in the Q1 research journal by combining the descriptive research, phenomenal, and then also the perhaps correlations, yeah. So these are the another tips for you to prepare the complexity of the research design by having the mixed method, yeah. And another example is this is in my 2013 research show on the, again I use the No Plastic Bag campaign. I hope it's close to this faculty of business, economic and business, yeah. So this is also another way on how we combine this experimental and correlational research by identifying the cause and effect of the situation by having identify the independent variables and also the dependent variables. So from this research, we know that there are already affected consumers by having this policy initiative, and then perhaps it need to be strengthened by having the plastic bag tax. Yeah? Currently, it's still on the voluntary basis. I'm not sure in Jakarta, perhaps already is still in the voluntary basis or already you have already specific plastic bag tax. Yeah. Maknanya seperti rokok ya, rokok sudah ada cukai rokok juga kan. Nah ini plastik juga ada cukainya juga. Bukan cukai apa sih sini? Pajak ya, pajak ya. Nggak tahu mungkin apa di Jakarta sudah ada pajak plastik gitu ya. Kalau belum, dilarang. Ya, betul. Di Malaysia juga dilarang. Dan tapi dengan adanya charges, this charges is function as cukai, ya, pajak tadi. Nah, dan pajak itu digunakan di peringkat local authority atau state ya. Kerajaan negeri Selangor, Penang, ya, they have special collection for these plastic bag charges or tax, ya, and then they use it to for another activity at the city or state level, for example untuk membiayai campaign plastic bag atau membeli shopping bag berbelanja ya, shopping bag, so that it will educate the people to not to use plastic bag again. So these are very complex that I explained in this phenomenal by using this framework just now. Yeah. So that is very complex that actually various discipline can involve. And then I hope it also can be a very good case study for Faculty of Business and Economic also. From the microeconomy, what are the factors that affect these plastic bag charges on tax or levy? Yeah. It's very common already in developed countries, and then we are in developing countries still exploring on how is the mechanism. But in Malaysia, that is already as a tools for the state government to collect this as part of their pendapatan ya, pasti kalau telah income ya for the state ya. So that's, but then there is also a pro and cons ya. But then state seperti juga provinsi mempunyai kuasa di setiap provinsi ya, jadi mereka mempunyai kuasa untuk itu. It's very good case study, and currently they also develop the environmental fund for the local authority, for the NGO, and the university also get involved in these activities. Yeah. This is also another for validation of, I just use this for example on how is to validate in terms of the research design, on how to validate our research. This is my current 2021 research. This is also published in the Q1. This is all related to household carbon footprint. Kita mau mengukur ya bagaimana sebenarnya karbon yang sudah dihasilkan di peringkat rumah tangga ya. Dan at the end, what the thing that I highlight in red circle is actually on how is at the end the conclusion need to get back to our research objective to explain what is the limitation, what is the result, and what are the conclusion and the useful of the research for these policymakers. So this is, I think, it's very in line also for faculty business and research, for faculty business and business, yeah, economy and business. Yeah, back to this quantitative research. Also, we have this qualitative research design. Just to refresh again, that our quantitative research by having the survey, I think, is very common here, and also correlational research, but not for the experimental unless we establish our own. Let's say kita ada kampung, special kampung, misalnya kita bikin community engagement atau project ya. Maybe we can set up as an experimental or living lab, ya, for example, atau desa angkatnya UIN, misalnya desa binaan, ya, itu boleh menjadi satu mengukur dari segi trennya, ya, mungkin tahun pertama mungkin dia sadarnya kurang, tapi kesadaran environmentnya akan meningkat dengan adanya pembinaan campaign dan lain sebagainya, dan itu adalah menjadi tolak ukur dari mungkin untuk melihat aspek pembangunan lestari di desa binaan tersebut misalnya ya. Dan itu ada juga menjadi salah satu tren juga di Malaysia ya, untuk melihat how is the contribution of academia to the local people ya. Kadang-kadang kan orang akademia itu, universitas itu kadang-kadang terlalu eksklusif, jadi dia tidak keluar ke reach out to the village adjacent. So itu adalah salah satu cara juga. Untuk qualitative research design, we can use either grounded theory studies. There are several type of research design for qualitative. Case study, historical studies, action research studies. Action research ini melibatkan kita sebagai pelaku juga, ya, dan juga melihat apakah terdapatnya perubahan dari segi let's say consumer behaviors, ya, dan phenomenological studies dan juga ethnographic studies. Dan ini adalah salah contoh untuk activity yang kita akan jalankan kemudian. Mungkin saya akan jelaskan kemudian, ya. Dan selain research design, just to again, we are entering the phase two, component number two for our today's presentation. Yeah, to avoid the confusion between what are the difference between research design and the research method. Yeah, so this research method is focusing on the procedure that we'll use to collect and analyze the data, while the research design is the overall structure of the research. Yeah, maksudnya. Research methodology is under research design. Yeah? So research design determined earlier before we start our research. Yeah? But and number two, focus on research method, focus on what type of method that are suitable to collect and analyze the evidence. Tapi untuk research design, we focus on what type of study yang kita perlukan and what kind of research result that we are expected from the research. Yeah, so that this is the different. Kalau research method, we are already know the topic and then we already plan for the research. Yeah, but research design is prepared early before the research conducted. Yeah, then depend on the research design. While the research design is based on the research question or problems. Yeah. And this is a major issue regarding what, where, when, who, which, how. So this is the short term of 5W1H. Yeah? Yang ini adalah in earlier part of the research design, uses question this 5W1H. Yeah? Meaning that we hope by having the research design, now we have a systematic plan to study the problems, and then in the research method, we have the various process to collect and analyze the data. So this is, okay, I will go through. Okay, this one is, we are entered for the third section on the determination of the population, sampling and method of data collection. So for those who are already determined the topic, yeah, again, you should identify who is your research population. Yeah, a large, but this is defined as a large collection of individual objects that is the main focus for your scientific query. Yeah? So for example, your population is this in certain village, but your sample is to require for you to conduct the questionnaire for this village, you are only require certain percentage, yeah, for this sample to represent this population. Yeah? So, kenapa kita perlunya population for the research? Yeah, because it's impossible for us to conduct two questions to perform the survey for all the people in this village. Yeah, but we have to select for the samples, and this sampling method also has several category. Yeah, either you will use this as a simple random sampling or systematic sampling non-probability. So, by having this probability simple random sampling, so you can analyze the data according to these two type of data sampling methods, yeah, probability and non-probability. And this data sampling process also involve identifying and define the population, select the sampling frame, choose the sampling method, determine the sample size, and collect the data. So this all this process, I hope you already have this a step. Yeah, it's part of your research that we will use it in our activity later on. And this is also activity that to show that your sampling method can be part of the of course this the general research on your studies. Yeah? and the activity actually I plan to use this as an activity, yeah, but I think we don't have much time, so I will continue this presentation until the end, then the activity will continue after my presentation, yeah? Yeah, so this is a various type of data collection. I'm sure you already determine what kind of data collection that will perform for your research, yeah? Whether you want to use phone surveys or online survey or in-person interview, yeah? Sometimes for in-depth interview, you can use for case study or qualitative method, yeah? Whether for the phone survey or online survey, you can use the survey, then you use the quantitative research designs, yeah? And these are the various method data collection in more structured approach. You can either, again, whether your research is focused on the secondary source or on the primary resource. Yeah? For the secondary resource, of course, the data collection may be involving the statistical book from BPS, Badan Statistik, yeah? Yeah, the various BPS, yeah, yeah. So this is Badan Statistik. That is a very easy for you to get first in order to identify the certain area is already have what are the characteristics of the population, the geography, yeah? So you can use this secondary source as your first start, yeah? After that, then if you want to go into your primary data collection, then you can go to sampling for that area. But at least you already have the secondary data to represent this area. Of course, this is depend on your research on the studies, yeah? So you can, the document mentioned for the secondary source is on the, whether you can refer to the census document or service records, yeah, government publication or early research and etc. But for the primary resource, of course, observation on top of the survey that you want to conduct, you can also doing the observation by whether involving the participant or not. So this is also to give more rigorous result at the end for your research, yeah? Interview and questionnaire. So this is another examples of population, sample population, then juga data analysis, yeah? I will share with you later on. Just this is to help you to design your research on your studies, yeah? So this is actually at the end on the in brief, yeah, on what must be in the research design is actually at first you have to have your clear statement for your research problems. What is the hypothesis and what is your dependent or independent variables? What are the procedures, tools, and techniques, the population and the method? So all of this is must to be in your research design first, yeah? And after this, whether if you want to go the detail on the research method, that is another stories, yeah. But this is on the second one, in the identification variable, this is part of the research methodology. On cause and effect, you might be identify this as part of your research. Identify your topic first, and then you can identify what are the independent variable and dependent variables. Independent variables meaning that the variable that are experimental, manipulates or change and is assumed to have a direct effect on the dependent variable. Contohnya adalah allocating participants to either drug or placebo condition to measure any changes. In well experimental study, the independent variable is the only important difference between experimental and control. Ya, ini contohnya kalau dalam experimental study untuk kajian berkait dengan kesehatan penduduk atau kesehatan penduduk, ya. Tapi untuk seperti saya bagi contoh tadi untuk the consumer behavior, for example, yeah, you want to choose whether you want to see whether there is an effect on the independent variables of the woman and man, or in terms of the level of awareness, in terms of the plastic bag chargers, or the attitude, or the practice, yeah. That is to show this effect on the independent variable that cause the effect to the dependent variables, yeah? The knowledge, for example. Yeah? So next, again, Another things that we have to prepare for the research design is the research hypothesis, whether it's predicted or our hypothesis relationship is to be tested by scientific method. So this is also another statement that link between dependent variable and independent variables. The role of hypothesis also actually to guide the direction of the study and identify the facts that are relevant for the studies, yeah? And help us to provide the framework. Remember the framework for the No Plastic Bag campaign, the stakeholder involvement, yeah? Perhaps we have the hypothesis know that there is no effect on the plastic bag charges to the stakeholder, yeah? But at the end, we identify that through the hypothesis, we identify that there is an effect on the plastic bag charges toward the stakeholder involvement, yeah? And okay, I will not go into the details, yeah? We'll share with you the slide. This is perhaps is any of you already prepare or having the research or study that having independent variable and independent variable and independent variable, you can use it by end of this training for our Padlet activities, yeah? And for the quantitative, I'm still focused on the quantitative. Actually, now is how to create the scaling in terms of the construction of measurement. We are very familiar in terms of the Likert scale, yeah? Agree, not agree, and neutral, and or satisfied, not satisfied, very satisfied, dan seterusnya. Five scale of measurement. So this is the respondent characteristic that indicate the feeling, attitude, or opinion is the most important aspect of the measurements. Yeah, the scaling itself is the assignment of the object to number of semantic according to a rule. In scaling, the objects are text statement, usually statement of attitude, opinion, or testing. Yeah. So ini adalah salah satu contoh level of measurement. You should able to identify what type of the measurement scale that you want to use. Yeah, sama ada nominal, ordinal, interval, or ratio scale. This is also part of your research design. Yeah. Nominal scale, maknanya you want to use the simple scale in order to identify, you put the numbers. Yeah. For example, 1 for man, 2 for woman. This is very common. Yeah. Ordinal scale, you give the values, yeah, in terms of, for example, satisfactions, whether excellent, very good, poor, or worse. This is an example of the ordinal scale. So this is also part of the research designs. Yeah, for the interval scale, the scale is used to rank the attributes. Yeah. On what are the numerically equal distance on the scale represent the distance that we are trying to measure, so the characteristic. Yeah. For example, 1 and 2 is equal to the difference between 3 and 4. The difference between 2 and 4 is twice the difference between 1 and 2. And this is very, maybe I should give you the example of this, the interval scale. Yeah. For example, for food supply, you are requested to indicate your score on the concern blank and circle the appropriate number on each line. Yeah, mungkin berkait dengan food supply, if you are required to identify the scale in terms of numerical format. Yeah, in terms of the whether the food itu is fresh, tastes good, value for money. So this is used to indicate. Yeah. Same like semantic format, the fresh, you can, for food supply, you can indicate whether you are excellent, very good, poor, or worse. This is also part of the research design. So all of these need to be predetermined before the data collections, of course. Yeah? And the ratio scale, this is also another properties on how you identify the interval scale together with a absolute 0 point. Yeah? Contohnya, the number of customers of a bank's ATM in the last 3 months in the ratio scale. Yeah? Atau you want to look at the difference between 10 to 15 minutes in the same as the difference between 25 to 30 minutes. Or 30 minutes is twice as long as 15 minutes. So this is the ratio on how you can use it in your research design. Yeah. And for the non-comparative scaling, you need to evaluate a single object. Their evaluation is independent of the other object which the researcher is studying. The non-comparative scaling technique juga akan menggunakan continuous rating scale and itemized rating scale. Yeah. So these are also another scale that you want to use by during your questionnaire designs. Yeah. This is an example of the continuous rating scale. Yeah. Contohnya, how would you rate the TV advertisement as a guide for buying? So you are, if you are mentioned about strongly agree and either is strongly disagree. You can use this for the scale for consumer behavior, for example, yeah, or any other research related to business and also economics. Yeah. Yeah, on the scale type A, you can measure the strongly agree to strongly disagree 1 to 10, for example. Yeah. So these are also related to the analysis method that you want to use, yeah, whether you want to use the descriptive statistic or if you want to use the analytical multiple regression collection, you can use it as a factors or variables. Yeah. The scales, yeah, this is a very common Likert scale from strongly agree to strongly disagree. It's very common. And then the statement, normally the item variable is neutral. If you want to use the item variable in in negative statement, you need to change the statement at the end of when you want to start the analysis. Yeah. Yeah, this is I think we are very familiar with this Likert scale. Yeah, you can use it for either correlations analysis or multiple regression, factor analysis, and etc. So for those who are doing quantitative research, these are among the option that mostly adopted by the researcher. Yeah. And again, yeah. This is just a review again on the quantitative type of the research design by using quantitative and qualitative data collections. Research design process, which also you have to identify the same process. You have to identify the topic, the objective for your topic and why you choose this topic. What are questions that you are hoping to answer, the research question. And then what are the theoretical framework? For example, if you want to use framework apa dalam biasanya dalam quintuple helix atau quadruple helix framework for innovation, for example, yeah. You want to use, if you want to test this quadruple helix, you can test it in certain community, for example, or certain business and the stakeholder, for example, involving the community and also the government, yeah, on the very specific, of course, very specific topic. And in determining and sequencing research method, what methods will help you to answer your research question? This is also part of the research design process. Yeah. Site and participant selection, piloting and refining research design and method, and also the validity. And this is an example for the research design. And I hope we can, if you look at on the research design that I would like to propose in this learning activity, if you already have the topic, I would like you to have to identify the research objective. What are the data that you would like to use in order to address, to answer your research objective? And then what are the research method analysis, and also the expected research outputs? Yeah. So shall we start the Padlet learning activity for research design? Yeah. I will share the slide. Oh, sorry, the Padlet activities. May Bu Rika boleh share Padlet ya dengan ini di dengan partisipan di chat mungkin ya, atau mungkin kita boleh and if there is a sesi question and answer for my.
Ya, baik Bapak Ibu, terima kasih. Silakan jika ada yang mau bertanya bisa di chat room atau raise hand ya, bisa langsung ditanyakan.
Mungkin kita bisa terus ke paddled learning activity ya. So that by oh, oke. Okay. Boleh, boleh, boleh. Iya, betul. Oke. Okay. Okay, maybe you can share the address in the chat, yeah? And then share with the participant on online. And then I try to share here. Stop sharing. Oksimil. Oh ini lagi you share. Ya, ini gimana ya? Minimaskan ini gimana?
Keluar dulu.
Oh, ini. Oke. Okay. Nah, share. Share this one. Yeah, for the activity, I would like to suggest for the participant to prepare the table for first table. Maybe I will share this one too. Okay, this one. Yeah. So I would suggest for the participants to prepare the table like this one. This is actually the template for. Oh, sorry. This is the template for research design. And then I hope for the participants can use your own research or study, and then create your own objective. Find what are the potential data that supports your research, either secondary data or primary data. If it is secondary data, you what kind of the research method or research method analysis that you would like to propose, and what are the expected output from the first objective? Yeah, this is I gather from my students also last semester. Yeah, the research is related to a certain village or rural suburban. Yeah. And they use the GIS, geographical information system, GIS, to collect the data. And then they need to have the old map of this village. Yeah? And then they need secondary data from Census Statistic Department, where they can provide the geographical data or profiling the socioeconomic profile of this area. Yeah. And then, of course, the research objective is created by, in order to identify the history and morphology of the townscape in this area. Yeah? And the research method they use here is by using the previous studies, literature reviews, and also by having the field observations. And they should describe and then write the result from this site visit or observations. And then for the method analysis, they have the analysis of urban pattern, assessment on the existing physical characteristics of the town, and then analysis on the legibility and permeability of the study area. So at the end, the output for the first objective is to have the image or identity for this area. Yeah. Yeah, this is just an example. So perhaps you can come up with your own, start your own table first. Or I can perhaps also share with my past research. Yeah. This is from the No Plastic Bag Campaign survey. Yeah? For example, the research question is on the, to what extent the consumer aware of the No Plastic Bag Campaign and how is the level of knowledge, attitude, and behavior? And then what are the policy implications from this campaign? Yeah? So from this research question, we should also develop the research objective first and then identify the methodology and also the analysis. So this is very important for us to create first so that you are tak hanyut, yeah? You are tak lost, get lost in during your research. Yeah? So by having this research design, at least for the first four components, yeah? The methodology, of course, you can choose whether you want to use quantitative or qualitative, as we discussed previously on the research design component. And of course, the right research objective, defined research objective, is very important. Sometimes in the research objective itself, it's already represent whether you want to, for example, to identify the correlation between independent variable and dependent variable. This is also part of the research objective statements. Can we start? Yeah. No, I mean, independent. Okay, maybe I will show first, yeah, the how to use the pattern itself. It really is very, very, you share it. Okay, okay. So on the, you can pick up this plus for you, for example, yeah. The plus, you can start. Yeah. And then if you want to create, if you already have your own file, you can choose your file. But at first, you should create your own Microsoft Word on the table, table Excel or Microsoft Word. You create first, like the previous example that I used. So you can save it and then you can show it here. So I think the first step is you should create your Microsoft Word, the table first, like the one that I present just now. Oh yeah. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Di cari mana? Di WhatsApp ya? Di WhatsApp. Bentar ya. Okay. Jadi first step adalah create this table, eh? This is the first step. And you can use Microsoft Word to use your table, to create the table, and then identify what are your research questions, research objective, methodology analysis. Buat dulu yang ini. Mana?
Jadi Iran dan Lebanon.
Boleh.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Iya, izin bertanya, izin Dr. Erika dan Pak Soyendra dan moderator Gumayani. I want to ask about, first of all, I'm going to catch up about this asynchronous learning method. Yeah. I want to know what is Padlet first, because it's new for me, and from the explanation from Dr. Irina, we should prepare the research design first, yeah?
Yeah.
Isn't it? Okay. Yeah. After we prepare the research design, and then okay, we're going to continue to upload it on the Padlet.
Padlet, yeah. Okay, Padlet is actually a very interactive and flexible learning platform, yeah, and it's very good for us also as lecturer to be more interactive with our students, where when we give instruction, I think I forgot to say that there is instruction on top of the research, on top of the title in our Padlet for this session. On this instruction, I give it to this participant for this section, for this session. I ask you to prepare for your research and then create your research design. But of course, it's easy for you to develop first at your using your Microsoft Word, and then by having this kind of table, and then you can upload in your post it in your Padlet in our Padlet for this session. At the end, we will have a various research design by each of the participants who are posted in our Padlet for this activity. And at the end also, I will share with you on the PDF version, or yeah, in a PDF version to the secretariat, so that you can have your own. And then actually this is also a free software for the lecturer, also can register and then download freely, and then using it to help us to be more interactive with the students, especially with our challenging learning by having this e-learning, ya. Kadang kita nggak tahu ini student ini catch up atau tidak, ikut tak kita punya lecturer, ya, ada to test them. So that is why we give this kind of activity. So by having this also, I using it to helps also your own research. Perhaps if you have your own research but you are still not sure what type of the what how is the research designed for your research, then you can use this session as part of your to help you to develop your research design. Yeah, at the end you can be more organized in terms of your research, and then more and clear on how is each of these research question and what type of the methodology that should be used for the certain specific objective, and then what kind of the analysis and expected output that will generate by having this research design. Yeah, so it's a free software actually, but one, if you want more, of course the free software has very limited function also, but at least it's enough for us to start with. Yeah, but if you want to use further for your own research, and then using it for various another interactive learning for your e-learning especially, I will share with you on how is this Padlet can help us. Mm-hmm. Also, yeah. I hope I answer your questions, Saudara.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Rina, because I'm searching a method that I'm building an engagement with my student, especially in online and you said in learning forum, because about two years previously, I lost my engagement with my students. I'm going to search another method how to catch up develop engagement with my student. Especially I'm teaching this research subject, yeah. Okay. So I have a lot of response from my students, sir. Still not clear, okay. So I think I will try this Padlet.
Yeah. Jim, I will share with you my Padlet and then you can have a look that it's not only for research design actually, yeah. It helps you also to scope your students' research by having research mapping, for example, yeah. And also method is very, very interactive and very flexible, very easy to use, yeah. And then I will show you step by step about the special about the Padlet, yeah. Yeah, now with this online learning, we force ourselves also to find ways to engage our student, right? Yeah, if any of you finish with your research design table, so you can start upload it in our Padlet, and then maybe I can start with mine. Sekalian aja pakai research sendiri ya, jadi biar sekalian jelas dan juga membantu dalam kita punya.
Jadi pakai table punya pemerintah sendiri ya?
Iya.
Bapak Ibu bikin table seperti yang
bikin di table.
Yang apa namanya, tampilan sesuai dengan kalkulasi dan matematika.
Iya. Boleh. Dan sebenarnya ini juga kalau saya bisa share ya, ini juga merupakan satu inovatif dalam kita ngajar research gitu ya, atau juga melakukan research ya, dan boleh sangat membantu student-student dan juga kita untuk mengontrol kita punya kajian ya.
Dr. Rina, can I ask more question?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in my screen that in Padlet view, I see your name Irina SZ. So you now as a lecturer, I'm a student. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And then there are a title about please create your research design. So me as a student, okay, should write down about my research design and then click the below what is it,
the
pink one, okay,
one, yeah,
so
one,
me,
yeah.
And then me as student do the upload, yes, isn't it?
Yeah, in okay, the subject, you can write your name and the title of your research, for example, to differentiate your task with the other students. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You can write your name first, and then wait. Let me share with you. No. Yang mana? This one. Can you see this? This. Okay.
Yes.
Screen, please. You can. Okay.
Now the same one. Okay.
Please upload. Yeah. You can choose upload. Okay. Yeah. Sebelum sampai sini, kita bagiin dulu bu yang sini yang put yang pink plus ini ya. Yeah. Okay. Each of you can write your name here, please.
On the subject form.
Yes. Subject form. Yes. On okay. The subject form. Your name. Huh? Your name. And then you choose upload. Yeah. And then you choose your research design that yang you buat tadi, ha? Huh?
Okay, miss. Okay, miss. Please wait. I'm still writing it. I'm your student now.
Okay. And then you can publish it. Yeah. This is example. My example. Yeah.
Oh, I see. The view will be like that. Yeah. The name and the publish. Okay.
But not only that. If you want to insert photo, for example, for your study area, for example, map. Yeah. Or perhaps you have frameworks, yeah. You can choose take photo here, and then select your. If you want to start the camera, you can start camera. But if you want to choose the, yeah, you can use the camera if you want. Yes, and you can upload here, or if you want to provide the link. So Padlet is very easy and very interactive, very flexible. Yeah, for us as a lecturer. You can also provide this link for to share with the student. For example, if I want to share my current Padlet, for example, yeah. So I will share this one and publish it, just like that. Boleh. Exactly. At the end, we are like a notice board. Yeah. Yeah. So yours, other person, every student has this. And actually, this is a very good in co-learning. Yeah. We are actually learning each other. You learn from yours from your for other research. Oh, kalau case study buatnya begini. Oh, kalau survey seperti ini. Kalau so everybody has their own research, right? And everybody create your own research design. And then once you post it, and then you can this Padlet. At the end, I will share with you. Don't worry, I will share with you the whole very nice Padlet compiling your research design. And then Bu Erika mungkin boleh print besar-besar, and then you can show it in the on the notice board, yeah. And this is part of the activity of e-learning. It's very, very innovative currently. And then you can join any competition exhibition after this. You have this activity with your students, yeah? Various topic, various activity. I will share with you after this. Yeah. Huh. Kalau if you want to search image, for example, pasal tentang Yogyakarta gitu ya. You can choose this one, and then you can push it, update. Sama tempat yang tadi juga, ya. Yeah. Contohnya kan di sini ada banyak tuh bu ya. Nggak apa-apa, ya. Yeah. So untuk to make your sekarang kan kita jadi banyak Padlet ya. Jadi banyak task board ya for your task kan. Then you can insert the picture to make your activity. Interesting compared to other students, yeah. If you want to remove, you just remove it. Okay. Here, there are many function here. If you click on the three dots here on the pink box, yeah, three dots here, you can see that there are many function here. If you want to, let's say you take a picture or you take a video, short video, you put into your file here, and then you can put it here, your video record, and it makes your activity more interesting. Yeah, yeah, it's very, 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 very in trend sekarang nih, Bu, dalam e-learning.
Miss Irina,
yes.
On your experience, how many amount of students should be efficient in this Padlet? Is it more than 20 or below 20?
Or even 40, so I can
40.
Even 40, yeah.
Okay.
50, so maybe I can share my students' reflections. Yeah? Sometimes after our finished teaching, we would like to look at on how it's.
Oh, you can show your picture, yeah?
Yeah, you can put your picture here. Okay. Because I want to remember them. Yeah, so
Narcis, show up.
Pictures, yeah. So each of them, normally after the teaching, we ask them to reflect, yeah, on what your learning experience with me in one semester. What do you know? What do you want to know more? And I'm thinking what you have learned, and then what was the best thing you have learned from one semester with me. So this is all in interactive. I never see them face to face during the COVID. Again, it's very challenging. But then, alhamdulillah, by having this, they are very bersemangat. Yeah.
So this is the part that we have our feedback to the lecturer. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
And then this another Padlet is I use for my competition on the. Iya, per activity, Bu. Ini ya. Iya, ini ada join Padlet di sini. Ibu join Padlet di sini, buat nama sendiri, nanti ini sendiri.
Wow, you have a lot of Padlet here, though.
Yeah.
Nice.
Ya, ini contohnya ya. Saya juga pengen tahu, ini semua sebenarnya activity e-learning ya. Kadang-kadang saya pengen tahu nih anak bener nggak sih ngikutin saya gitu kan. Jadi saya kasih aja nih tas di sini, kasih linknya. Ayo isi, ini jawab, ini gimana. Anything unsustainable about current way of living? Saya minta mereka, siapa yang jawab di sini berarti mereka attend. So that is how I take the attendance. Kalau enggak, nanti kan mereka nggak datang lah apa ya.
Yes, that's the problem.
Iya, ha-ha. Iya, ha-ha. Iya betul. Iya betul. Di charge sih di mana ya? Dan ini juga ternyata banyak digunakan dalam convention, competition e-learning. Sekarang ini kan banyak ya. Yang ini adalah saya buat untuk di Korea tahun 2020 ya. So even saya boleh masukkan video untuk saya punya research di dalam sini. Dan saya tinggal kasih aja ke linknya ke itu ya. Dan alhamdulillah sudah dapat gold winner di Korea Invention 2020.
Alhamdulillah. So this video is on Padlet, you upload it.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Sekarang memang tengah tren begini ya, untuk ini untuk. Iya, jadi anak-anak juga nggak bosan. Ini di Johor, perbatasan dengan Singapura. Ini bridge to Singapore, where there is a reclamation, land reclamation. It kills the mangrove forest in that area. Dan ini jalan yang di atasnya ke Singapura. Kita sampai jalan ke sini ya. benar-benar itu. Ya. Eksperimental. Ini yang tinggal. Itu sebedepannya udah Singapura. Tulis guide-nya adalah anak kecil ini ya, mereka tuh anak nelayan yang terbiar karena kawasan mereka terancam, mereka udah nggak ada tempat lagi, jadi mereka di training untuk jadi turis untuk mencari makan juga. Jadi kita bayar mereka dalam satu namanya klub alami. Dan saya dapati dan ini ada leadernya tadi perempuan itu. Yes. Sustainability leadership untuk ya Nathan ini dekan-dekan tadi. Dekan-dekan dari high education institution. Dan kita mereka kasih mereka action research. Ah, ini action research ini juga bagian daripada. Jadi kita lihat juga dan researchnya juga masuk SWOT analysis, peta, mind map semuanya ada di sini. Ini kawasannya. That is why it's very important for you to identify the secondary data, the map, the issues, yeah, so that it can reach your research. Ini framework yang kita gunakan. Ibu-ibu juga bisa identify framework apa yang digunakan untuk research tersebut. And the map that we produce from the programs. Ini jadi sedikit menyimpang, tapi enggak juga ya, just to look at on how the research design for action research. Ya.
This benefit future development, this area, is a community-based tourism, local heritage value. SL4's framework procedures established during the project has been applied to other regions in Asia.
Yeah. Actually, economy and social, karena dia ada three pillar, jadi ekonomi dan sosial pun masuk juga. Ya. Ini just a teaser lah, a teaser.
Terima kasih.
Okay.
Miss Irina, yes. I'm apologize have to leave because I have to attend my class after this. Thank you very much. May your knowledge sharing is blessed. See hope to you soon. I'm teaching at Christian School Raffles, do you know?
Okay.
And I'm now also studying at PhD on UIN Dr. Prabhakaran Sariah.
Okay. Very good.
Oke, permit to leave, Pak Soehendra, Bu Erika, mohon maaf, saya leave duluan. Terima kasih. Thank you very much. See you when
you see. Terima kasih, Pak.
Terima kasih. Yeah, I hope there is any of you have posted the activity on our research design, yeah? Ada yang bisa masukin? Yang apa udah buat belum? Oh ini udah nih, ini udah oke.
Kan semuanya mesti coba.
Iya, iya betul. So mungkin kita boleh coba Ibu Rahmawati ya, boleh Bu Rahma ya. Bu Rahma. Video banyak. Mana tadi hilang. Ini betul ya, ini Bu Rahma ya? Oh iya. Ya Bu Rahma mungkin boleh start present your research design ya. kurang besar nggak? Oke. Okay. Huh? Yeah, you explain your research design, your title, overall.
So, in fact, found that the law of accountability in Baitul Mawatamwil and the lack of the regulation. So, this study want to know the current level of disclosure of the financial and non-financial information among BMT in Indonesia. This study will use quantitative research with content analysis.
Content analysis.
Yes, and this study will use descriptive analysis.
Content analysis, maksudnya kualitatif ya Bu ya?
Ya kualitatif. Oh,
berarti
ya.
Metodologinya mixed method ya?
Ya mixed method. Ya. Jadi saya tulisnya mixed method.
Mixed method jadi, ya. Kuantitatif okay. Dan kualitatif mixed method.
Mixed method. And then this after I finished this study finished to know the level of disclosure financial and non-financial information, and then continue to know the difference, the extent and the quality of disclosure between micro, small and medium BMT in Indonesia.
So, perhaps is sorry Bu, mungkin kalau boleh tambahkan satu kolom lagi di sini ya. Expected output.
Oh, expected output. Oke.
Okay. Ya, mungkin boleh Ibu-ibu juga boleh tambah expected output di sebelah kanan. Jadi kita ada 5 kolom di situ. Dan kita lihat dalam analisis ini mungkin kita juga untuk deskriptif Ibu bisa lebih detail. Independent variable-nya apa, dependent variable-nya apa. Sudah sampai ke tahap itu gitu ya.
Iya, iya.
Oke. Ya.
Oke,
yang kedua.
Yang kedua, and then the study want to investigate the differences in the extent and quality of financial and non-financial disclosure between micro, small and medium BMT in Indonesia. So, this study will use also content analysis and then to analyze the between the micro, small, and medium in, disclosure of BMT, this is ANOVA test, yeah. And then the last one.
Maaf ibu, yang kedua ini independent variable-nya apa?
Nah di sini tidak melihat independent variable-nya bu, karena memang dia hanya lihat perbedaan disclosure saja.
Okay, between these three type of BMTI. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's comparison or what?
Comparison.
Comparison.
Yeah, comparison research. And then.
So at the end, what would be the expected output?
The expected output. We want to know what actually the difference between the among the big micro, small, and medium.
The level, quality level.
The quality balance. Level of disclosure-nya.
Between among these three.
Yeah, among these three BMTI. Of the type size.
Okay.
And ini kan based on the size.
Okay. And then the ANOVA test will test whether there is
difference
between among these three.
Yeah, among these three of size of the BMT.
Okay.
And the last we want to know the perception of stakeholder of BMT on the issue related to the importance of Islamic social capital. The last one is based on the first and second one. So the idea comes up from the result from the first and second one.
First and second objective.
Yeah. Jadi macam riset objektif yang ketiga ni comes up because of the result.
Okay. Or
because of that we use interview. To know the
to refine the issues. Okay, so this is overall is mixed method.
Yeah.
So at the end for the objective number 3 to explore the stakeholder perception of the importance of disclosing Islamic social capital information in the annual reports of BMTI. So how is it this one?
To know the perception, the importance of the information, Islamic social capital information in annual report of BMTs.
So meaning that you want to prepare the the scaling measurement.
Yeah, the scaling measurement. We use the perception.
Meaning that is quantitative. Bukan kualitatif ya, mana kuantitatif.
Dia juga guna lupa saya tulis ini. Dia dua.
Mixed method.
Mixed method juga. Jadi survei dan interview.
Interviewnya in-depth interview.
In-depth interview.
By using guided questions.
Yeah.
Yeah. So question. You already identify the item for each guided questions.
Yeah.
Ya, mungkin boleh ditulis di sini nanti apa namanya di analisisnya itu atau di metodologi metodologinya ya mungkin ya.
Iya, di metodologi.
Apa item
item. Iya, saya ini ya. Oke, first the study will use survey and then after that.
Yang untuk kualitatif analisisnya menggunakan in vivo atau kita kan ada kualitatif survei software menggunakan in vivo ya untuk melihat temanya bagaimana apa ya in vivo itu mungkin boleh dimasukkan
tadi buru-buru soalnya
so mungkin menurut Ibu gimana apakah sudah lebih jelas dengan menggunakan research design dengan menggunakan Padlet atau
sudah lebih jelas ya cuman mungkin ya. Memang kita harus explore lagi
karena refine, memang refine terus detail
kalau kita gunakan ini mungkin untuk secara pribadi kita apa ya ininya
pribadi boleh sangat sangat membantu nantinya ya tetapi untuk mungkin workshop small scale groups ya dengan
tim ya
atau project juga ya untuk kadang-kadang kita mengontrol project itu management of the project or control the project kita udah sampai mana nih gitu kan itu juga menggunakan project juga it's very mungkin boleh di share among the team group ya jadi kelihatan gitu kan research-nya sudah sampai mana hasilnya mana siapa yang buat terjun lapangan fotonya dimasukin sini ya kan bisa untuk jadi kontrol juga kan Bu ya saya surveinya apa aja nih udah buat apa aja bisa di situ juga it's very very flexible dan juga apa ya versatile
berarti membangun kalau untuk dalam mengajar untuk membuat case study pun juga sangat membantu ya
sangat membantu boleh juga mungkin Ibu boleh masukin kalau misalnya ada secondary data atau artikel jurnal masukin aja di sini mungkin satu padlet untuk satu research project misalnya ya ada data collection ada primary data ada literature reviewnya nggak situ
ini dan, free ya Bu
ya free tapi kalau untuk lebih saya rasa untuk lebih selamat ya secure dan ada banyak fungsi lain saya sarankan untuk
mendaftar
membayar saya rasa nggak sampai $20 ya setahun
oh tidak sampai
sangat murah
oke
nggak sampai $20 ya dan okay, nanti okay. Untuk inovatif learning innovation juga bisa nanti
iya sama dengan Grammarly kan juga gitu ya
Grammarly.
Kan ada yang gratis ada yang membayar
satu lagi Quillbot udah pernah dengar Bu Quillbot ya itu juga sangat
bagus itu paling bagus ya Bu ya dibandingkan yang lain
fungsinya beda-beda ya kalau itu kan untuk
paraphrase ya
bagus juga
oke
ya mudah-mudahan bisa membantu ya ibu-ibu dan kita dalam menjalankan research juga ya mungkin ada adik-adik atau yang lain yang bisa untuk sukarela present mereka hasil kajian atau research desainnya ya
silakan teman-teman presentasi hasil research desainnya
ya
jadi yang di upload
coba ya saya ya nanti bisa di link di sini tinggal share aja linknya YouTube-nya nanti tinggal masuk di sini ya mau ibu masuk juga boleh mereka masuk juga boleh tapi kalau ibu mau ini jadi ibu punya platform learning innovation ya atau research innovation bisa ini saya masih nggak share ini masih saya masih tertutup maksudnya untuk saya dengan student aja sebenarnya saya bisa oh iya
bisa dibuka semua
bisa
jadi walaupun yang tidak berkepentingan
kalau saya ini kan saya buka sekarang nih pak Nah, Bapak klik di sini bisa nggak? Coba bisa kan ya? Ini saya masih buka, saya masih open kan? Ini juga ada bagian yang saya buka, ada yang enggak kalau nggak salah. Karena
bisa di protect ya?
Iya bisa.
Nggak semua grup discussionnya.
Iya. Siapa lagi ini? Ibu Eri Wirdana, Ibu Mariani bisa di share atau siapa lagi? Umi Yati?
Bumi,
bumi,
coba
bumi. Boleh? Lagi, Mbak. Oke. Apa lagi? Fadil?
Fadil, Pak Fadil.
Pak ya. Fadil? Ya. Iya. Gak apa-apa, gak apa-apa, Pak. Nanti masih lebih fantastis lagi habis ini ya. Pas pose ya. Mungkin dari research objective ini bisa identify nggak Pak, independent variable apa, dependent variable-nya apa gitu ya?
Jadi yang di research objective-nya itu pertama tentang harga. Jadi harga, pertama harga, yang kedua fundamental. Fundamental baik itu makro atau mikro. Jadi di situ nanti termasuk pada GDP, terus apa income per kapita, dan inflasi. Termasuk ke objektifnya. Sedangkan analisanya ini, analisa dasarnya event studies, yaitu ngitung pra, reason, dan pasca-nya.
Mungkin bisa dijelaskan juga yang ARCH punya analisis ini hasilnya apa gitu, expected output gitu ya Pak ya, dan GUTS itu apa gitu ya. Memang kadang-kadang kita kalau udah jadi ini orang malesan nulis. Tapi kadang-kadang kalau untuk student gitu ya, untuk guide mereka gitu kan, mereka jadi ada lebih kelihatan gitu ya kalau menggunakan ini. Terima kasih Pak Fadil. Siapa lagi yang mau share? Yang lain ya?
Ini di luar ini ya. Tadi kan kayaknya mudah banget tuh menentukan membuat kotak tabel ini. Nah, menurut saya justru ini beratnya tuh di tabel ini nih.
Iya.
Tabel buat expression. Nah, kira-kira ada tips nggak gitu ya memudahkan kita untuk membuat tabel ini? Ini yang menurut saya sih, gitu. Ini yang paling beratnya.
Paling berat di sini. Iya, betul. Mungkin dari segi memang untuk
event cukup produktif nih,
gitu kan? Ya, mungkin karena lambat, sebenarnya saya juga agak lambat juga kalau nulis ya. Jadi ini kadang-kadang tulis yang udah 5 tahun lalu research-nya gitu, karena baru terbit gitu ya. Tapi memang itu it takes time gitu ya, untuk menulis juga dan juga reviewing proses juga ya. Tapi sedikit untuk menjawab soalan Bu Erika tadi. Memang untuk menentukan research objective itu juga berdasarkan kepada research question, of course, ya. Dan untuk kalimat, sentence for the objective itself is already determined what are the analysis that you want to execute later on, ya. For example, kalau udah komparatif itu mesti ayatnya akan to the sentence would be to compare variable A and B. Let's say if you want to look at on the again by using the this no plastic bag to look at on the effect of the no plastic bag campaign to the level of awareness. So that is already plastic bag campaign itself. It can be part of our questions whether there is an effect on the plastic bag campaign or campaign on the consumer behavior atau knowledge misalnya kan. So dalam question itu dia akan berkait juga dengan questionnaire development. So dalam situ kita akan lihat sama ada efek atau tidak, itu tadi scale nominal gitu kan. Tapi kalau misalnya kita melihat efeknya kepada practice atau shopping bag practice, for example, atau shopping practice, kita akan bisa juga membuat satu range of question dalam bentuk Likert scale misalnya kan. Misalnya, the plastic bag is that affect my daily shopping. Or I forgot to bring my reusable bag. Or I forgot to bring... So this list of question can be part of the item variable, dan itu akan again to determine our research analysis. So indeed, it's very important to identify your research objective because it's already the sentence for the research objective itself is already represent what kind of analysis that you want to study. If you want to study the factors, for example, to identify the factors that affect the consumer behavior for plastic bag, for example, the consumer behavior for sustainable lifestyle, for example. So to identify to is a question for example, like if you remember the multiple regression equations, yeah. Why one yes or no, for example, and then if you have range of variable x1, x2, x3, x4, and etc. So this one, it can be x1, x2, x3 can be the socioeconomic profile, but the rest can be whether it's Likert scale questions, yeah, or ordinal scale, and etc. So this already determine your research analysis. If you identify, let's say, to evaluate or to examine or to compare, that is the sentence for the objective. Yeah, emang it's really really in depth and it's really heavy thinking and it require a laborious work to identify your research objective. Yeah. Yeah. Huh. Yeah. 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 Uh-uh. Yeah. Uh-uh. Yeah. 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 Tertinggal gitu ya. Iya. Yang riset saya publish yang 2021 tuh seperti itu adalah hasil riset 2015 ya. Sebab tapi kebetulan memang dan mungkin this topic is also evolve through time because the carbon magnitude carbon footprint is really really in trend ya. But then mungkin my knowledge as well at that time is not sufficient enough to produce this article up to Q1. So it's also a journey for me and also my team, also my co-writing member that we are also Zoom, Padlet, very interactive dan juga, oh ternyata our thinking and our experience also as researcher also determine that perhaps 5 years ago, we don't have this kind of thinking. So that is also by having the new. Kalau sekarang kan carbon footprint is COP 15 lah, climate change is very evolved dan cepat gitu ya Bu ya. Jadi kita juga dalam literature review-nya, dalam introduction-nya, so we wrap up the current situation. Even though our research is 2015. Yes. Yeah, ha-ha. Dalam in research in bagian chapter, dalam bagian section methodology, of course the data collected kan itu semua kan mesti ada ya Bu ya. Iya, 2015. Oh. Ya. Yeah. Dan ya, yeah, itu makanya mungkin re-edit. Ya, yeah, ilmu aku kebetulan the topic itself is very in trend gitu ya. Jadi alhamdulillah jadi banyak yang cited juga dan kemudian banyak memang tren sekarang ini kajian ke arah sana gitu ya. Iya, iya. Unless you can make it as a trend topic currently, yeah, and then perhaps by sometimes during kita buat itu, yeah, dia dah buat lagi gitu kan, kita lagi analisis, dia dah buat lagi, so it's okay, but we cite them, So to show that we are keep up with our with current situation with scholar, yeah, scholar ada the scholars punya research tu kan, ya si ada buat lagi, gue baru mau buat gini dia ada buat lagi gitu kan, kan selalu gitu ya. Tapi it's okay, but we cite the world and then it shows that we are also knowledge that this topic is evolve. Iya, ikutin terus. Ya kadang-kadang kan kita lagi buat ini sibuk yang lain lah, buat apalah gitu kan, jadi ketinggal-tinggal gitu. Itu memang saya juga punya masalah yang sama seperti itu. Ya. Mau tanya atau gimana buat ini? Oh iya, yuk. Silakan bentar ya. Oke. Okay. Tadi apa ya? Oh. Ibu Umi ya, Umiati. Ibu Tini. Ibu Tini, mungkin boleh ya, silakan Bu Tini.
Iya, terima kasih Dr. Iriana. Jadi ini kebetulan kalau di ini apa saya baca beberapa jurnal gitu ya. Jadi kalau kita punya beberapa topik, ternyata satu topik itu diselesaikan dengan tools yang berbeda gitu. Jadi ketika kita masih mengidentifikasi indeksnya, maka kita harus menggunakan pendekatan indeks. Begitu kita ingin mengklasifikasi dan predicting apa kota atau kabupaten yang dengan basis yang ini, kita harus gunakan apa tools yang berbeda gitu. Nah, apa
peringkat data ya, sudah di peringkat data mining ini ya.
Iya, karena untuk classify ini kan lebih mudah dengan menggunakan machine learning. Kemarin apa namanya? Ya sempat belajar juga tentang machine learning itu seperti apa. Kemudian pola spasial. Cuma saya pengen tanya nyambung enggak ya apa Bu Dr. Iriana antara apa namanya question 1 dengan question berikutnya gitu. Jadi setelah saya mengukur indeksnya kemudian saya mengklasify, terus saya ingin melihat pola spasialnya, pola spasial pemetaan wilayah, kemudian berikutnya ininya apa namanya saya ingin mengidentifikasi kondisi kausalnya dan yang terakhir melihat implikasi atau pengaruh gitu dari satu variabel ke variabel lain, apa antara ini ada yang kurang nyambung atau masih relevan gitu.
Ya. Jadi itu pentingnya kita buat table research design yang pertama tadi ya, Bu ya.
Mungkin ya.
Boleh buat dulu research objektifnya apa? Research objektif yang satu itu mungkin menggunakan metode indeks komposit ya.
Iya, kebetulan.
Kan nggak ada objektifnya, nggak ada research questionnya, nggak ada. Jadi mungkin kalau ada itu semua mungkin kita bisa lihat. Tapi karena dengan tidak adanya research question dan objektif ini, kita pun nggak tahu ibu sebenarnya mau buat apa ini gitu ya. Jadi harus jelas dulu research objektifnya apa. Misalnya research objektif satu untuk develop the Islamic Human Development Index, for example, ya. Yeah. And then this the method is apa gitu, ada analisisnya apa, menggunakan apa, apakah menggunakan score atau matrix atau dan lain sebagainya. Jadi saya minta ibu kalau boleh buat research design table-nya seperti tadi dulu. Jadi jelas research question-nya apa, metodologinya apa, dan juga untuk analisisnya tuh variabel-variabelnya apa saja gitu ya. Karena indeks ini sebenarnya udah cukup besar ya Bu ya. Untuk membentuk satu indeks aja ini kalau boleh saya tahu ibu dalam level master atau PhD ya ini? PhD ya. Oke. Okay. Jadi kalau untuk indeks ini juga establish developing the index ya maksudnya di sini ya. Islamic Human Development Index ya.
Iya. Yeah, betul.
Itu objektif pertama. Mungkin kita start dengan membuat objektif dulu ya sebelum sampai ke sini. Jadi kalau udah ada research design table tadi jadi akan lebih jelas nanti. Apakah sekarang udah banyak metodenya analisisnya ini, apakah analisis ini menjawab objektifnya atau tidak? Nah, itu dulu yang paling penting.
Baik, nanti saya coba buat itunya dulu, Miss.
Iya.
Terima kasih sebelumnya.
Sama-sama. Mungkin saya bisa share yang student saya buat di Pendet ya. Oke, okay. Yang ini. Ya, ini contoh. Oke. Okay. Student final year yang sudah buat ya. Dan ada berbagai macam. Mereka juga yang bikin transport, yang masukin bus gitu ya, sebagai contoh ininya ya, foto-fotonya gitu ya. Bisa kelihatan nggak? Oke, okay, the first title, Measuring the Quality Delivery and Competency of Planning Permission Submission Professional Built Environment Provision in Selangor, for example. Dia menggunakan kualitatif dan metode datanya adalah menggunakan primary data dan secondary data. Primary datanya menggunakan semi-structured interview dan secondary datanya menggunakan to evaluate various submitted development proposal report yang di menggunakan content analysis ini sebenarnya ya. Dan dia review various proposal yang submit dan juga menggunakan literature review dan ada juga sample population-nya meliputi interview with selected expert from planning field dan juga melakukan survey terhadap professional in built environment. Method sampling-nya adalah maximum variation purposive sampling dan menggunakan identification variable IV, independent variable-nya adalah contributing factors-nya apa, time, human resource, dan sebagainya. So, dependent variable-nya adalah quality of planning information. Dan ini adalah method processing and analyzing data. So, this is example of the research design untuk qualitative data. Ya. Untuk yang satisfaction assessment of Kuching Metro Bus Service, ya. Ini kuantitatif, mungkin bisa jadi ini juga. Ada juga yang melakukan qualitative research menggunakan action research studies. Yeah. As usual, to make your Padlet interactive atau interesting, yeah. They put the pictures yeah, here. Dan selanjutnya, detail about independent variable dan method data analysis. Yeah, ini adalah contoh various research design. Ya, ada lagi yang mau sharing mungkin? Udah sampai situ ya. Okay. Ini juga saya termasuk rendah, yang lain-lain lebih banyak ini ya. Cuma kadang-kadang sebenarnya ada sih satu tips ya. Kalau mau cepat naik hash indexnya, jangan terlampau variatif. Kalau very specific. Kalau udah finance, Islamic finance, apalagi narrow down, dan stick to that one. Kalau saya kan udah sebentar ke carbon, sebentar ke conservation, sebentar ke waste, sebentar. That is my risk lah, because environment is big. So that is why my hash index is low. No matter how hard you try, because my topic is very diversified. Dan jadinya itu. Tapi kalau yang very specific itu kan cepet aja gitu ya. Misalnya dia menggunakan Rush model, my friend Pak Bambang tuh ya. Pokoknya Rush Medal, Bambang Suminto, UM sekarang udah pindah ke UII, International Islamic University Indonesia ya, di Jakarta. Dia ras model, tapi dengan ras model itu udah kemana-mana gitu ya. Dan ras model tapi bentuknya, subjeknya macam-macam gitu ya. Itu cepet banget gitu ya. Jadi kalau saya bisa jadi tips yang very specialized gitu ya. Kalau udah misalnya financial, islamic, syariah, apanya lagi. Itu aja, satu stick itu aja. Tapi kan kadang-kadang kita kan nggak bisa satu itu aja ya. Kadang-kadang harus kesana lah, kadang-kadang dikasih ngajarnya yang lain lah gitu kan. Tuh risiko development tuh ya gitu gitu ya. Development sustainability tuh is big topic, jadinya lambat hashtag yang mau naik, no matter how hard you try gitu. Dan stick pada keywords, misalnya hanya 5 keywords atau 10 keywords itu aja misalnya ya. Dari 10 tahun yang lalu ya dikutip-kutip di situ aja research topiknya atau keywordsnya gitu ya. So you stick to that one, insyaallah by perhaps using qualitative, quantitative, using different case study, using different place ya. But then the topic is the same. I mean finance, syariah, or apalagi yang lebih spesifik gitu ya. Tapi is kalau you in depth and then you have lama-lama you akan buat advanced statistical modeling lah, SEM lah, kan macam-macam ya. Dan itu kan melibatkan stakeholder yang lain atau consumer yang lain, itu kan jadi macam-macam juga. Tapi your core expertise is financial, Islamic financial sustainability misalnya, atau Islamic finance misalnya. Itu tuh cepet tuh kalau yang very specified gitu. Atau kalau dia GIS, GIS aja gitu. Kalau saya jadi ikutin, saya ini udah pengen celak-mencok. Karena itu dikasih terang, Bu Dina ngajar ini, ngajar itu. Jadi, ya mau gak mau atau kamu nolak. Ya. Tapi at the same time, ya harus nulis. Sebenarnya seperti tadi, ini sebenarnya tuh saya ngajar saya melepas ya, tentang research tahun akhir, final year. Dan mereka tuh juga, ya seperti itu. Udah buat belum gitu. Nanti gak buat lah, males lah. Apa. Jadi, it's force me also to find way on how the student engage with me, and then to take the attendance, you have to post your work at Padlet. Jadi baru saya ambil attendance. Iya. Jadi mereka juga lebih interaktif, lebih apa semangat ya, karena bisa masukin macam-macam. Kan ada yang masukin ano apa animasi lah apalah. Ada yang sebentar waktu itu nggak sampai setahun ya, kebetulan 6 bulan deh, nggak kebetulan. Itu juga it's true time actually, frankly speaking, it surprised me also. Wow, 6 bulan udah bisa ini, dan nggak nyangka gitu ya. Mungkin karena itu data is variety. I actually my second Q1 tuh I include my student punya final year bachelor punya thesis ya. Tapi saya combine dengan secondary data, saya combine dengan in-depth interview, saya combine dengan apa lagi ya? And then saya develop the index gitu. Jadi banyak gitu kan. Dan mungkin karena case study, especially kalau developing country ya, kita develop country kan mungkin udah biasa, tapi when we adopt develop country punya atau framework at global level, and then we using it in our context, dia orang akan ngelirik tuh. Biasanya editor dia suka gitu yang kayak gitu. Belum ini pertama kali. Itu yang saya juga mungkin lihat, saya punya plastic bag campaign 2013 tuh saya juga terkejut juga, karena yang saya refer tuh yang di Ireland, yang di developed country itu udah tahun 2008-2009 mereka udah established dulu kan. Jadi wah nih pertama kali nih membuat seperti itu gitu kan. Jadi akhirnya jadi ini, jadi setting lah gitu, jadi banyak gitu. Abis itu banyak yang tentang kaji tentang plastic bag gitu, padahal plastic bag aja dikaji gitu ya. Tapi because we are from economics, microeconomics ya, environmental economics especially, that is becomes a new lah waktu itu. Tapi sekarang udah nggak lagi, udah it's 10 years. Acukai apa acuk? For policy, public policy. Normally,
hmm.
No. Actually, that is why in action research, it's good if we as academician also need to link with the local authority. Perhaps you can promote, kalau kita baca kan, oh di sini udah biasa, ternyata di Taiwan udah ada. Di mana-mana tuh udah ada, di Malaysia memang mungkin government-nya juga update juga ya, jadi mereka very aggressive juga, dan that is why they create this financing mechanism, kan creative financing mechanism ya, seperti itu ya. Sebenarnya sih negara maju udah duluan udah establish seperti itu gitu kan. Cuma mungkin the academia can share the result and then convince the local authority that this kind of method is common, is already become a source for local authority. Sometimes local authority kan nggak ada duit ya untuk infrastruktur, atau nggak cukup uang untuk infrastruktur dan lain sebagainya, atau mungkin untuk campaign green campaign gitu ya di plastic bag-nya itu. Yeah. And then seperti di Penang, the Penang State Government, they have environmental fund, which is governed by the state government. And then all the supermarket have to donate, have to reporting. Ada plastik 10 sen. Ada. Enggak, misalnya kan kita biasa 10 sen ya. Charges 10 sen itu kita punya charges tax-nya. Iya, Dan dia harus lapor. Which is sebenarnya itu yang jadi debatable dalam environmental economics ya, Bu ya. Karena kan polluter pays principle, the polluter should bear this impact for the environment. Iya, kita sebagai consumer yang pakai plastic bag. Tapi sebenarnya kan debatable juga. Loh, itu yang produser gimana gitu kan? Masa dia juga kan produce, dia berarti ngambil untung dong gitu. No. Sebab yang kita bukan membayar kembali kepada produser yang jual plastik. Enggak. Tapi that fund itu yang di allocate to local authority. Dan local authority harus ada legitimasi juga ya untuk govern this money gitu kan. Dulu tuh di Penang ya sampai ada recycle bin pada bagus-bagus gitu ya. Ternyata daripada environmental fund itu, dan sampai buat composting untuk di peringkat community gitu ya, daripada charges itu sampai million loh hasilnya. Tapi ya. Iya, kita bisa design the research itself that we are part of the of the program. For example ya, UIN mau buat campaign plastic bag bekerjasama dengan Indomart for example, dan kita engage CSR-nya siapa ya, Pertamina lah contohnya gitu kan. Kan kompleks tuh, quadruple helix kan sekarang ya modelnya, ada akademia, ada Pertamina private, ada local government gitu, ada consumer. Itu kan udah cukup tuh syaratnya untuk action research. Tapi the campaign itself mungkin kita boleh design dengan local authority, kita buat audition lah dengan local authority gitu, contohnya Tangerang apa gini Pak, kita mau propose seperti ini bla 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 bla. So it's really we help the city to establish this kind of initiative, and then at the same time to educate the consumer. Kan kita harus membentuk satu sistem ya. Kalau seperti itu kan, ya. Yeah. So that is action research, because we are as a researcher, we help to design this together with the local authority. And then if we can develop this proposal to sell to Pertamina, and then because sekarang ini private organization ya, seperti Pertamina tuh, apalagi yang masuk dalam bursa stock exchange, main board, second board, they have to have sustainability reporting, and then they need, it's not only touch and go philanthropy, ngasih uang sudah bye-bye gitu, enggak, sekarang mesti yang ada terukur CSR-nya. What is the changes? Sekarang misalnya collection-nya plastic bag-nya sekian, atau at the same time we do the survey, oh sekarang penduduknya udah enggak pakai lagi plastic bag, mereka semua kalau ke sana belanja di situ pada bawa plastic bag sendiri, bag belanja sendiri misalnya, contohnya ya. Yeah, then through time, it's not only one year punya project. ya. Dan itu yang berkelanjutan kan, jadi sustain ya. Itu baru contoh dari segi itu. Kalau misalnya ada desa binaan, Ibu mungkin boleh buat di sini UIN Living Lab nih, jangan diganggu nih. Siapa-siapa aja di sini buat master plan-nya dan buat Bu Erika bagian apa, Ibu Umi bagian apa. Jadi nanti jelas masing-masing sumbangannya dan itu berapa tahun punya itu, dan kalau besar master plan-nya, sebesar proposalnya, we can sell to Pertamina and Pertamina have accountability to our deal, for example, or the project, and it can be a very impactful. Karena mereka harus ada dalam sustainability reporting to have this environmental social governance namanya. Sekarang bukan CSR aja lagi, Bu ya, ESG. Udah ke arah situ kan, sekarang itu lebih kompleks lagi ngukurnya. Iya. Ya, that is a part of action research yang memang kita memang kadang-kadang aduh malas banget yang desain itunya gitu ya, udah gitu. Tapi kan kurang. Iya, iya. Exactly. Connection. Itu yang kadang-kadang kita mau KPI itu mesti smart ya, Bu. Kill one bird with three, kill three bird with one stone. Yang teaching learning-nya kita dapat nih sekarang nih. Dan gitu research-nya juga kita dengan publish ambil data sekarang dapat. Pasu yang kita pengabdian masyarakat mau action research, buat aja campaign, buatlah ceramah, begitu kan, buatlah FGD, buatlah SWOT, dapat action research. Jadi kan kita satu project itu kadang-kadang teaching and learning dah beres gitu kan. Iya. Iya. Sekarang memang the current trend is action research. Because and also banyak university yang sudah ada quote-unquote desa binaannya seperti Urban Living Lab, dan mereka bekerja sama dengan local authority ya, seperti Tangerang lah, Bekasi lah, apa itu didampingi tuh Bu. Mereka tuh jadi, dan kadang-kadang our knowledge is far more advanced than them. But then, kenapa ninyanya tak nyampai, tak sampai? Patutnya padahal benar-benar yang simple, yang sebenarnya kita, itu yang hamblum minanas kita sebenarnya kan. Tambungan kita banyak di situ, tapi kenapa kita nggak reach out gitu loh. Nah, itu yang kemarin juga saya baru datang ke Ngelanggeran juga, ya Allah cuma begini aja padahal gitu kan. Kok kita nggak sampai gitu ya. Ya, ada juga yang. Ya. Nah, itu yang dibilang tacit knowledge-nya juga kan, Bu. Dia by experience. Actually, they have a very special skills juga kan. Yeah. Kalau dalam sustainability dibilang tacit knowledge. Nah, itu yang kadang-kadang kita tacit knowledge. Tacit knowledge. Itu local knowledge yang memang dihasilkan oleh penduduk yang terasi dari segi praktisi ya. Dan itu yang kadang-kadang kita kan nggak tahu, kita taunya teori aja kan, konsep gitu kan. Tapi begitu di lapangan, mereka kan yang lebih tahu kan. Nah, itu sebenarnya tacit knowledge mereka yang kita gunakan. Nah, itu kalau di sustainability, kita blend between this tacit knowledge and local, tacit local knowledge dan juga scientific knowledge. Kita nih biasanya kan emang taunya textbook ya. Nah, blend dari itu yang kita sekarang ini saya gunakan approach sustainability science di situ. Kemarin saya baru present di, nanti saya kasih link-nya di ITB, Planologi. Saya kasih ceramah untuk rural tourism dan sustainability. Rural tourism. Desa wisata saya ambil contohnya. Tapi di situ saya mau nunjukin how to translate. Kan kita sekarang SDG kan ya. But do you know how you contribute to SDG goals? Do you know how is it? Tidak tahu kan? As if like, ya udah di sana aja gitu, kita ya sibuk aja sendiri gitu, we don't know how to contribute gitu kan. But then actually that is another homework for us actually ya, and non-state actors academia, NGO, community-based tourism, that is actually, there is a role for us actually there. Tapi sekarang masalahnya yang itu tuh kayak eksklusif sendiri gitu, tapi nggak nyampe trickle down ke bawah gitu kan. Itu yang kemarin saya tunjukin ke dalam YouTube kemarin, webinar, nanti saya share dengan Bu Erika. Itu based on our research dengan Udayana 2017 di Bali. Dan dari situ juga kita buat masterclass lah dengan UNESCO, funded by UNESCO, masterclass on sustainability science. So itu yang kita coba promote sebenarnya untuk akademia juga keluar dari kepompongnya, jangan cuma di dalam aja gitu ya. Kita kan sekarang emang dituntut gitu juga kan, cuma pusing banyak banget kan yang mau dikerjain. Nah. Betul. Iya. Iya. Betul.
Itu kalau kolaborasi kan? Iya, tapi kan juga masih saya efeknya gimana? Terlalu memang.
Iya. Betul. Iya. Betul. Iya, betul. Bisa research. Di dekat-dekat aja tuh dulu Bu, yang desa binaannya apa-apa, yang kadang-kadang kita mikirkan faktor waktu juga gitu ya, kita bukannya selalu bisa ke sana juga gitu. Dan tapi kadang-kadang amazing gitu ya, kadang-kadang baik kita by creating collaboration tuh kan kadang-kadang kan ya silaturahim juga ya, buka silaturahim gitu, dan mereka tuh kadang-kadang membuka mata kita, wah ternyata mereka tuh membantu dalam aspek kita tidak duga-duga gitu, selama ini gitu kan. Dan itu yang jadi bikin ketagihnya tuh di situ kadang-kadang gitu. Oh ini ternyata bisa bantu ini. Oh ternyata dari ini bisa buat ini gitu kan. Jadi dari situ juga yang bikin our writing tuh is enriched because of the rigorous data gitu. Bukan kalau dari little trivia aja kan kayak itu aja gitu kan. Iya, karena insight-nya tuh dari mereka. Mereka tuh is a good informant loh sebenarnya. Dan makes our research more rigorous dan juga apa namanya kayaknya jejak gitu ya. Kalau enggak kan apa sih ini research-nya nih, apa sih konklusinya gitu kan. Tapi kalau dengan adanya mereka, contextualization, that is the word. Contextualization, that, itu yang makanya kajian tuh dalam konteksnya itu tuh akan jadi lebih lebih nyata gitu ya kalau kita buat menggunakan orang lokal gitu kan.
Misalnya kita kan termasuk namanya judulnya sophisticated,
ya mungkin bisa lihat ini kayaknya lihat judulnya aja mungkin Dani apa sih ini kok ya kok Po Fadis ini apaan sih gitu kan. Ini sebenarnya kalau dilihat mungkin ya Ella cuma orang asal doang gitu kalau dia baca gitu kan, cuma because mungkin karena that is another thing that we should able to identify in which framework or theory that our research contribute. Dari situ baru kita akan dilirik oleh editor untuk itu langsung boleh ya pokoknya langsung diterima untuk review selanjutnya gitu, belum diterima lagi gitu ya. Ya, jadi kita harus able to identify which framework, which theory or concept that our research contribute, no matter you duduk kat mana pun, Tangsel ke, atau ini kajiannya di Royal belum ya gitu, orang asli gitu ya. Kalau melihat siapa sih yang mau ke sana, siapa sih yang mau lirik gitu kan. Tapi karena we are able to identify our contribution, dan kadang-kadang reviewer proses itu juga penting gitu. Jadi yang that is why we need second reader. Karena kita kalau udah baca ini terus, aduh nggak tahu lagi nih apa sih, udah kayak udah mentok gitu kan. Tapi nanti karena second reader tuh komen, oh iya ternyata dia melihat dari sisi yang lain gitu kan. It help us to identify our value actually in our paper. Itu yang jadi review proses, jangan lihat review proses itu sebagai proses yang ngeselin gitu ya. Aduh udah gini. Memang iya mereka kita ditampar dulu untuk sementara, ya udahlah diamin aja lah sehari dua hari gitu. Nanti lihat lagi gitu sebenarnya. Oh ya benar juga ya, jangan emosi gitu kan. Sebenarnya mereka tuh ada point, is of course there is a point there, dan bila kita kita respon, then it improve a lot our manuscript, then it becomes, wah gue nggak nyangka dulu gue jadi, ya itu kadang-kadang judulnya juga tadinya nggak begini gitu kan, tiba-tiba oh dapat ide, oh jadi masih highlight dari livelihood-nya gitu kan, mungkin tadinya cuma survei biasa aja gitu tentang conservation, tentang apanya orang asli gitu kan, orang indigenous people gitu ya. Tapi when we are contributing to the body of knowledge, the concept itself, and then it happen, it becomes a significant contribution to the knowledge itself. That is why it's not only our research is not contribute to solve the problem at the practical level in the real world, misalnya mau lihat tentang bisa enggak plasiba ini memberikan masukan kepada local authority. Tapi at the same time, we are also contributing to the scholarly works that already established in this context. Gitu ya. Contohnya di sini, livelihood indigenous peoples, communities. Ya. Mungkin dari sini mereka, mungkin yang lain tuh tidak ada community-based conservation effort-nya, tapi yang ini mereka dapat identify gitu kan. Kita dapat identify gitu kan. So itu yang it's a long journey process actually, and during through time, then through interaction with the reviewer, that is actually they give us very valuable input, yeah, for us to look at the papers from different, by using different lens, for example, yeah. Yeah, itu juga yang apa lagi ya?
Yang tahu kamu itu reviewer itu berapa lama?
Setahun ya. Justru kalau di reject awal-awal itu sebenarnya dia mau kita benar itu kita untuk di potensi kita untuk diterima selanjutnya. Paper saya nggak pernah ada yang diterima. Awalnya memang ditampar dulu deh, bahwa kanan kiri sakit. Ya. Iya. Iya, betul. Yes, boleh. Iya. Betul. Iya, betul. Betul. Terus submit aja Bu, dan kita just respond through based on their request ya, based on their comments gitu kan. Karena kalau kita buat lagi, karena kita kan kadang-kadang kita kan uncontrolled juga ya, karena kita just respond through the respond based on their respond only. Sebab kadang-kadang kan after we do the edition editing process, dan kita baca lagi baru kita akan kelihatan, oh sebenarnya slightly different from the original intention, for example, gitu kan. Ada komponen-komponen lain yang perlu di ketengahkan, contohnya harus difokus dalam kita punya manuskrip tersebut, gitu ya. Saya juga ini ada nih, saya masih dalam hati saya masih ini saya harus publish di Q1. So I know the value gitu kan, karena nggak banyak. Saya menggunakan nudging tuh by Teller and Sustain in 2017, they got the Nobel laureates for in economics kan. Nah itu kebetulan saya buat researchnya tentang no plastic bag juga gitu. Kalau lihat apa sih ngutang-ngatik plastic bag dari kemarin dulu ya, tapi because it's interesting and then I look at from different perspective, dari environmental economics, dari consumer behavior, dari CSR. Nah sekarang ini menggunakan nudge itu kan, nudge proses. Nah itu juga yang briefnya udah publish, tapi saya pikir itu yang salah satu tips kenapa sampai sekarang itu masih nanya gitu sini ya, kapan mau publish ininya gitu kan. Tapi karena masih nggak sempat juga jadi belum ini, padahal udah kira-kira udah 70% lah itu gitu ya, karena resultnya juga udah selesai, analisis sudah selesai, cuma nulisnya tuh yang rasa masih belum pas gitu kan. Tapi yang short versionnya saya udah kelar gitu ya, dan begitu saya lihat juga wah ya ini udah kelar, orang-orang lain rupanya memang tahu karena memang topik itu memang baru dan memang akan banyak exploration, akan paper banyak yang keluar dari situ karena it's very interesting gitu ya. Ya dari situ gimana ya? Jadi saya ambil contoh yang ini ya, apa terkait dengan ekonomi dan bisnis, jadi ini dia nudge to promote sustainable shopping lifestyle. Ini juga nggak ada scopus, nggak ada apa gitu ya. Cuma saya nggak publish semua karena saya masih mau publish di Q1 rencana saya, dan ini udah menggunakan factor analysis, menggunakan regression, tapi yang ini cuma orang kata teasernya gitu ya. Tapi ini saya melihat aja, sebenarnya melihat kalau saya guna ini bisa nggak ya? Ternyata ditanggapin, diterbitin gitu ya. Nudge ini yang dikeluarkan oleh Taylor and Sustain berkenaan behavioral economics. Sekarang kan trennya ke situ ya, behavioral economics. Ya, Taylor and Sustain itu yang dapat Nobel tahun 2017 mengeluarkan ini teori tentang nudge ini. Nah, saya tuh lagi itu ya, saya tuh jadi iseng gitu kan, coba pakai teorinya ini bisa nggak gitu kan. Ternyata bisa, dan cuma saya nggak nerusin, nggak habis lagi saya buat, tergantung lah unfinished manuscript gitu ya. Udah mungkin kita bisa udah 4 jam 4 ya. Mudah-mudahan ini ada ya. Jadi kita udah ke, mungkin ada hasil lain nggak ya? So far udah selesai ya. Ya, kita ada beberapa ini ya. Ya, saya rasa sekian aja mungkin untuk selanjutnya bisa diteruskan learning padded activity-nya, dan link-nya saya akan bagi dengan Erika. Mudah-mudahan sesi ini bisa sama-sama ya, kita saling belajar gitu ya untuk selanjutnya. Terima kasih. Ya. Yeah. Ya. Yeah. Nah, itu kan yang paling tricky ya. Ya. Yeah. Iya. Betul. Iya. Kadang-kadang cuma kasih ceramah aja sih, Bu. Kasih ceramah misalnya kan, begitu nanti kasih satu skill untuk mereka misalnya kan. Nah itu dari observation, through time, dan ibu buat survey, itu udah bisa jadi research ibu juga, gitu kan. Dan nanti kalau, nah planningnya itu. Ya, yeah. Betul. Ya, yeah. Dan nanti mungkin kalau pas ada ibu ada kelas apa, misalnya sekalian aja ya, studentnya bisa ikutan juga turun gitu kan misalnya. Udah sekalian tuh KPI semua tercapai gitu ya. Sebenarnya bisa ngambil data juga, ibu juga bisa ngambil data, bisa ditolongin juga gitu kan. Ya, mudah-mudahan ini ya. Kalau nggak ada pertanyaan lagi, saya serahkan kepada Bu.
Baik, terima kasih atas pemaparannya. Sangat menarik sekali, nggak kerasa sampai jam 4.
Iya.
Ternyata ternyata menarik gitu ya, kalau misalnya dihayati, dipahami gitu ya, Bu. Nah, saya
akan memberikan kesimpulan dari kegiatan kali ini. Jadi sebelum kita meneliti itu sebaiknya membuat desain penelitian ya Bu, biar kita itu nggak bosen gitu ya, biar kita punya arah mau ngapain lagi nih setelah melakukan poin pertama gitu ya. Jadi nggak monoton di situ aja, nggak kesenengan nyari literatur review yang banyak itu dikumpulin tapi nggak di mapping gitu ya. Jadi itulah pro-nya riset desain. Di sini tadi ada kesimpulan yang menarik, yang penelitian yang sederhana tapi bisa jadi luar biasa gitu ya. Jadi kita pertama harus mampu mengidentifikasi kontribusi penelitian kita tuh terhadap pengembangan ilmu pengetahuan itu seperti apa. Jadi dikasih judul yang bagus gitu ya. Terusnya kalau misalnya sederhana, jadi kita bisa menggunakan cara lain untuk mengembangkan penelitian kita gitu. Dilihat dari berbagai perspektif gitu ya. Jadi bisa berkembang. Tadi contoh untuk riset desainnya ya sudah dipublish di Padlet. Pertama ada riset objektif, data, metodologi, analisis, sama outputnya. Ini ada salah satu tools yang saya pribadi baru tahu ya, yang namanya Padlet gitu ya. Jadi di sini toolnya menarik sekali ya. Jadi semua bisa lihat, bisa dikoreksi langsung sama teacher-nya gitu ya. Ini alhamdulillah ada free, terus ada juga yang berbayar gitu ya. Kalau berbayar kita serahkan ke Pak Wadik 2 ya Pak. Agar bisa dosen-dosen kita di sini punya akunnya gitu ya. Yeah. Nah, jadi nanti ini kan memulai ajaran baru nih Pak Wadik. Jadi mohon fasilitasnya gitu untuk dosen-dosen kita memiliki akun Padlet gitu ya. Mungkin itu kesimpulan dari kegiatan kali ini. Semoga ada ilmu yang bisa kita serap ya dari kegiatan kali ini. Kita akhiri dengan bacaan doa kafaratul majelis. Akhir kalam, wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Saya serahkan ke MC sebagai penutup.
Ya, terima kasih kepada Ibu Dr. Iliana atas pemaparan materinya. Mudah-mudahan apa yang disampaikan dapat kita amalkan dalam kehidupan sehari-hari. Dan terima kasih juga kepada Ibu A yang sudah menjadi moderator dan memandu jalannya acara. Baiklah, meningkat acara selanjutnya yaitu pemberian cenderamata. Untuk pemberian cenderamata ini kepada Ibu Dr. Iriana akan diberikan oleh Bapak Dr. Suhendra MM. Kepadanya dipersilahkan.
Udah ya?
Ya, berlanjut pemberian cenderamata. Ya, selanjutnya pemberian kepada moderator yang diberikan oleh kepada dari Ibu Cut Erika. Ya, selanjutnya foto bersama. Ya, telah selesailah pemberian cenderamata. Rangkaian acara demi acara telah kita lewati. Dan pada akhirnya kita sampai di penghujung acara. Mudah-mudahan acara pada hari ini bisa bermanfaat bagi kita untuk kedepannya. Saya Ahsanul Khaliqin sebagai MC pada hari ini. Mohon maaf apabila ada kata-kata yang kurang berkenan di hati para hadirin sekalian. Saya akhirin. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wallahul muwafiq ila aqwamit thoriq. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Mana?
عليك يا حبيب سلام عليك صلوات عليك يا نبي سلام عليك يا رسول سلام عليك يا حبيب سلام عليك صلوات الله عليك. صلوات